Hello everyone. Thanks for joining us on this call. I have today here with me Mr. Ashok Gupta, MD and CEO of the company, and Mr. Anil Pandey, Vice President Sourcing. I would recommend for the next 10 minutes, we'll briefly take you through our financial results. Please refer to the presentation that we uploaded yesterday on SEBI. Once we are through with the presentation, we'll open the conference for question and answer, and then you can pose your questions to us. So this is the presentation that you have in front of you. We will quickly take you through the company overview and industry overview for people who are new to the category or are joining us for the first time. Then we'll present you the quarter results. And post that, in case you have any question, you can pose it to us. So a brief overview on us. We're the oldest paint brand in the country. We have both decorative and industrial paints in our portfolio. We have a factory in each zone of the country servicing us, and we have around 5,300 strong distribution network across the country. The sort of paints that we make in the decorative and industrial covers the entire spectrum of needs that is there for the consumer, right from the basic bottom of the pyramid to basic paints to the high-end emulsions and decorative. And in industrial, we have three segments to be focusing on, which is protective coating, packaging, and marine. We've serviced a huge list of clients, and we keep getting repeat orders for prestigious projects like a Howrah bridge to a Rashtrapati Bhavan. The list of clients that we have with us covers the entire range from a government organization to an FMCG. Now, for both the verticals that we have, industrial and decorative, these are very different verticals in terms of product demands to the distribution and to the sort of needs that they have to grow. As a company, we are committed to invest in both the verticals, and we've shown a certain number of growth, which we'll share in a while, and we're committed to grow it further. A quick overview on the global picture. While Asia-Pac is the largest coating market with 45% market share, of which there are three countries which have 80% of it, and India is at 12%. If you look at the market as a whole, 75% is decorative and 25% is industrial. But if you look at it from a global perspective, the 75% is 40% from a global standpoint. So there's a huge potential to grow in the industrial segment. Again, while globally the entire market is very fragmented, but for us here in India, it's dominated by four big players. The industry has had a steady growth rate at around 10.4%. Industrial and decorative both have grown, though decorative rate of growth has been higher over the past few years. The projection of growth for the category as a whole is around 8.5% till 2024. So the industry as a whole has a pretty sound background, and the projection on the growth looks very positive. A quick overview on how our quarter has been. We're pretty happy to announce that we're reporting a V-shaped recovery in quarter two and are sustaining it in quarter three. Our revenue quarter to quarter has grown by 20%. Our EBITDA quarter to quarter is showing a 25% growth. Both the segments have increased and are showing a growth. Decorative is showing a growth of 28% compared to industrial at 10%. My production has registered a 33% growth over last quarter. If I compare my performance over the past few years, my EBITDA has improved by 45% in FY20 compared to FY19. The company has managed to reduce its losses by 53% this year compared to last year. And my interest expense has reduced by 20% in this year. A quick financial summary, my revenue has increased by 20% over last quarter, and my EBITDA is showing a growth of 25%. If we look at the quarter-by-quarter growth in revenue, I am presenting a 93 crore net sales this quarter. Breaking up into the two segments, industrial and decorative, the decorative growth rate is higher, but industrial is matching up. A quick summary on the volume, which has again shown an increase. Compared to last quarter, there's a 21% growth in volume. And compared to last year, there's a 2.8% growth that we are registering. Across the three factories that we are right now operational with, my net production quantity has increased by 33%. And one of my newest factories, the Nasik, which was added, is now showing a year-on-year growth of 67%. Going forward, my one and most critical priority is to turn net positive as soon as possible. There are various things that are happening across the two segments to enable this sort of growth and on both bottom line as well as top line. Once we open the forum for questions, you can ask across these two categories and probably then we can delve into it deeper. Now I'll open the forum for questions.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin with the question and answer session. Anyone wishing to ask a question may please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Participants, if you wish to ask a question, you may please press star and one. The first question is on the line of Hitesh Jain, an investor. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you for taking my questions and congrats to the management on fantastic execution on both revenue and cost during the quarter. Now, I have three main questions. First, you have talked about your goal of reaching 1,000 crores in annualized revenues over the next 2-3 years. How are you looking at profitability in this journey? Very specifically, if you could please help us understand the flow through of every incremental, you know, say 10 crores of revenues into EBITDA. Question number two, could you please comment on the pricing dynamics in the industry? It doesn't look like there has been a price hike for some time. And we have been hearing about some pressures due to increase on the raw material side. If you could please help us understand this for the industry and how it impacts you given the pricing gap that you might have. Very specifically, I was looking at your presentation and on a year-on-year basis, it looks like when we look at volumes, realization seems to have come down. So could you please explain that as well? Third question is more towards the industry structure. A big corporate house, Grasim, has recently announced its foray into the paints business, also a fairly large size investment. How does this change the market landscape, and does this put any risk or delay the timelines to the target of 1,000 crores in revenues that you have outlined for us? Thank you.
Thank you for your questions. So far as our goal is concerned, we were projecting and we have a capacity today by which we can reach a overall revenue of around 1,000 crores in around 3 years. If you observe, our Q3, the revenue is around 93-92 crores. On an annualized basis, it comes to around 360-370 crores. Now, if we can maintain our tempo of growth of around 30% year after year, we should be reaching somewhere around 900 crores. And that's what our objective is. We had a setback in this year because of COVID and many other factors, and that hopefully is behind us now. Things should return to normal, and we should continue our trajectory of 30% growth. With that, we will be reaching this. So once we reach even first year, that is a growth of 30% in next year, fixed costs remaining where they are, we should be in a net profit category right from beginning. So next year itself, we hope that we will enter the net profit category, and then from there onward, it will be growth only. We're talking about raw material and price dynamics. So industry in general tends to work on a stable pricing mechanism. We do not change our prices significantly. There has been significant pressure on the raw materials, particularly because certain raw materials, which are either based on crude or are imported from outside or based on imported raw materials, there has been a significant increase. The industry has been able to pass on this increase only not much in the quarter, last quarter, that is Q3. But the Q3, because we already had stocks available with us at the old prices, and the impact was minimal, so I think we were able to do it. But from Q4 onwards, we will have no alternative but pass on the, at least a part of the cost to the consumers. So industry, I think we're going to pass on this cost as in the current period, and that process already started. But yes, last quarter, impact was minimal. If you observe, our raw material cost as a percentage of our revenue has remained steady in last 5-6 quarters. So for new players are concerned, new players are coming up in a large way, particularly from the Grasim. They have announced a investment around 5,000 crores over the next 3 years. So they are going to have obviously impact on the industry. How much impact it will be, whether it will impact us or not, obviously will depend on what kind of products they bring. So if you remember, another new player had entered the industry some 3 years back, and they are already active. But there has been some impact on the industry. They have had their own share, but it didn't have any significant adverse impact on us. We are aware of the likely changes in the scenario after they enter, and obviously we will take steps to counter it. But our market share being so low, even below 1%, we feel we will be able to handle the pressure of the new player in a significant manner as and when they come.
Sure, sir. Thanks very much. That was very clear. If I can just squeeze in one small bookkeeping question. Is there any change in the debt position of roughly about 120 crores that you have given with your half yearly results? This could be either on account of, you know, the working capital cycle or the insurance claims that you had filed and you had talked about earlier. Thank you.
Oh, since 1st October to today, our debt position, our working capital limits, all of them remain almost same. There has not been any major change as such.
Sure, sir. Thank you very much and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, anyone wishing to ask a question, may please press star in one. The next question is from the line of Vedant Chagarwal, a private investor. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for the question and good set of results. Sir, I had a couple of questions. First is, you talked about 30% growth year-on-year once we reach PAT positive next quarter, right? So what gives you that confidence that, you know, what that you would be able to grow at that rate? That's first question. And related to that is that this quarter, right, compared to other competitors, our volume growth is not that strong, right? So from here, how do you see that we can grow beyond what market is going? That's first question. And then second question was on the generally when I read about the other paint industries, they mention about the number of tinting machines or the dealers or distribution that they have, right? So what is our go-to-market strategy for customers, right? What, how do we reach out to the customers? Is it like via this machine installation at the painters or the dealers, or is it like directly? I don't know. How does that work in a this sort of a decorative industry? Then the third thing was that in the, you know, I've been reading about a lot of other companies, not in the paint, but other industries, right? We have seen that, you know, a lot of unorganized sectors was decimated during this COVID period. A lot of organized players gained a lot of market share, right? So who is our competitor in the micro markets in which we are sort of operating in? I mean, if you can give a flavor of that and how are we competing with them in terms of this, right? So that will be really helpful.
Fine. So if you're starting from our growth plan, so if you observe in last year, that is before COVID, in 1920, we were growing at around 25-26% over the previous year. This year, there has been a severe setback. Yes, our growth in the revenue has not been as much as many other players in the industry. And it has taken us some time because of kind of markets we have. Our market share is primarily in the north and east, where the recovery has been slower. But having at this point of time, the recovery is almost full in these two territories. And that's how we intend to go back to our trajectory, what we had in 1920, or 25 to 30% growth. And basically what we are doing to do this is we are streamlining our systems. So if we observe, most of the players, they have been setting up their system for quite some time. And where we were not doing as well as the competition was, our systems and our servicing and our workings, they needed to come up to the level of our competition. I think that is where we are focusing, and this is from where we intend to get our market share. Our go-to-market strategy, as you mentioned, is basically two ways. One, we are focusing on middle to lower level of dealers. We are not looking at dealers whose sales are very high, the order of crores of rupees per month. We are looking at dealers whose sales may be around 5 to 10 lakh or below 5 to 10 lakh per month. As a result, there is a large number of players whom large people like large giants in the industry may not be focusing on. So we cater to those people. Again, in geographically, we look at more at tier 2, tier 3 cities rather than metro cities. So basically, we have made our own market, our own niche. We have positioned ourselves. In terms of paints also, we are not working on premium paints. Paints whose value may be 400, 500 rupees per liter. Our presence is very limited. We are more present in economical. So all the three things together are in sync, focusing on tier 2, tier 3 smaller towns, focusing on economical products, and focusing on smaller dealers. So this is our strategy, and these people have a bandwidth available to them for keeping additional brands, for keeping additional machines, and there this is the area where we have been able to achieve significant success. You mentioned about our competition. Since paint is a very common product, so our competition continues to be common. It's not necessarily anybody different than the big players in the market. So our competition may be same. Our pricing strategy also is similar. However, we are trying to work with a different set of customers. This is a place where we are differentiating from others. Instead of focusing on the same customer whom the big players are focusing, we are looking at different set of customers who are not being really, you know, getting that much kind of attention from others. So that's how we differentiate, and we have been able to create a market of our own.
Sir, on a follow-up to that, right, would it mean that the dealer that they're reaching out to, is there a capex from their end that they need to sort of set up a tinting machine or, let's say, a working capital that they need to have? That's one thing. And secondly, in terms of pricing, right, are we in the same segments in which our maybe, let's say, larger players are, right? So what is the incentive for a dealer to kind of keep our products in their store, given that space would be limited? Is there a incentivization scheme or something, or how does it work, sir?
Okay, there are a couple of incentives we give to dealers to keep our products. And so one thing is that most of the companies, they work on the principle of dealers having high inventory. So dealers are typically required to keep very high inventory because of so many reasons and the objectives of the companies. We are working on a principle whereby the dealer has to keep minimum inventory, and we replenish stock almost on a weekly or at times even twice or thrice a week. So our principle is the dealer please keep minimum inventory as against the principle of some other players who may be asking dealers to keep high inventory. This increases his return on investment. Second aspect is the margin dealer gets on our products are a bit higher than the margin he may be getting on some other company's products. And the reason is the MRP is almost same. So if you go and let us take a distemper from any other company, whether our distemper or anybody else, the MRP is almost similar, almost in close range. However, his net price which he gets, that means the differential between the price at which he gets and the MRP, is higher for us as compared to the competition. This is incentive. So these two are the incentive he gets, apart from other incentive of surveys, of visits, or other things, or annual visits. These are the two main incentives which a dealer is interested in talking to us in dealing with our products.
Sure. Sir, if it will be helpful if you can give a color on where we want, what is our current dealer base and where we want to be, let's say, to reach that 1,000 crore goal, where, how much we want that dealer base to grow. If you can share that and maybe, going forward also, if that could be part of the presentation, that will be very useful.
Okay. So, you see, on a gross basis, that means the dealers who might have been our customer at any point of time, our dealer base may be around 7,000 numbers, as against competition dealer base of around 50,000 to 1 lakh. Out of this 7,000-8,000, our people who deal with us on a regular basis may not be more than 3,000. So our one goal is to increase our dealer base. So we are intending that our regular dealers who are not more than 3,000 at this point of time should go up to at least 10,000. Total dealer base in the country may be more than 1 lakh. So we are, trying to reach a dealer base of not more than 10%.
Got it. Sir, one last question. I think when I read about the Indigo Paints, right, they had a strategy of getting into niche products, right, which maybe the larger players were not focused on, like floor paints and all that, right? So I understand the dealer base growing, that to be one strategy of reaching to that number, but in your scheme of things, that's like getting into some area which, larger players are not currently focused in, which is small niche in pockets, which can actually be more remunerative. Is that something that you are considering actively, or is it, how are you, is that something that you're, creating a niche for yourself, is that something that you're looking at? Thank you, sir.
Vedantia, hi, Meenal. So yes, you're right. Mr. Gupta mentioned earlier, we're trying to focus on tier 2, tier 3 cities, and that a set of dealers who are not too high-end, who are in the bottom of the pyramid again. So to servicing them, essentially, we do need the sort of products which support their sort of city that they might be in. And essentially, again, it means that I need to strengthen my lower base of my portfolio much more. And it isn't just about filling in the gaps that exist in the market in the product portfolio, but also supporting those products well enough to the extent that I can push secondary in the market. For example, putty, distemper, enamel, bulk of the competition might not give secondary schemes on those, and hence the movement of it might be slower at a dealer counter, and bulk of their schemes will focus on the higher end of the pyramid of the product portfolio, which will be emulsion. And as you know, emulsion is highly dependent on the number of tinting machines that you have in the country. So since we'll take our own time to really reach that number, we are trying to focus on the base products and trying to, and it's not just one thing that you have to do, it's the right product combination to the right sort of schemes to help push that product from the counter to essentially coming up with schemes so that the first level placements could happen with the new counters. So across all three, various things are being done to essentially manage that. And going forward, in the short term at least, we'll be focusing in that range. And once my dealer penetration increases to a certain level and I manage to build in my tinting machines a little bit more, is when I start focusing on emulsions in the higher range and new products in that segment.
Got it. So I think till we reach that 1,000 crore revenue, we will continue with the current strategy, and then we will assess from there how to grow. Thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, anyone wishing to ask a question, may please press star in one. Participants, if you wish to ask a question, you may please press star in one. The next question is on the line of Naitik Modi from OHM Group. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. Sir, a few questions. One is, if the tinting machines concept is a barrier for entry for for a player like us in terms of hiring new dealers, what are we doing about it? That's number one. Number two, if we are focusing more on the commoditized and low entry price products, where do you think we will, what could be our margins in the longer run? And number three, any views on why is competition in the industry, or rather new players entering into the industry and putting up green capacities? Aren't there enough existing assets which are unused or underutilized? You have some views on the same. Thanks.
Hi, Naitik.
Yeah, hi.
So I'll take the first part of the question. And like you rightly said, tinting machine is a barrier. But we also believe that tinting machine is not the only barrier. There are a few other things that need to come together to push emulsion. So yes, tinting machine is needed, and hence you need the distributor and convince the distributor to give you that sort of real estate to you. But then you also need a strong brand in the consumer segment to be able to push that range forward. And C, you also need the sort of service that is needed to push this particular segment forward. And fourth piece would be the product portfolio. So you need to have a very strong product portfolio cutting across various levels in the segment. Now on all these four, when it comes together, is when you will manage to take it to a 40-45% sort of a contribution rate that this industry works at. So we have a long way to go. So while yes, we are, and hence what I specify that while we are working towards this segment, but in the short term, there is no easy solution. It will take its time. It will be a step-by-step sort of a process that we'll have to follow across all these four parameters. And while that is happening, we will continue to strengthen our lower base of the portfolio, which is not dependent on the tinting machine per se, and where the competition is not focusing on.
You're talking about margins. So, you see, margins across the segments are in a similar range. Yes, the margin will be lower for us as compared to competition. So, whereas competition is looking for an EBITDA level of 18-20%, we will be looking at EBITDA level of 10-12% only. We are not really eyeing for something more than that in the short run. Once we reach that level, then obviously we will look for a higher EBITDA margins. And even, you know, talked of tinting machine, as Nigel was mentioning, it's exactly not exactly a barrier to the large extent, because many of the dealers are able to tint with the same machine, paints, and bases of all companies. So dealers are smart enough. They suppose they have Shalimar tinting machine, and we have a significant number of tinting machines in the market. Suppose they have my tinting machine, they can take the bases from anyone, and they, the same, by using the same formula, they are able to build the same color. So tinting machines are like becoming a common asset now. So that way, it's a tinting machine is one thing, and you know, our bases and bases of competition are quite similar. So when we sell our bases, their quality, their color, their texture is almost same. In fact, if you go a bit deeper, you will see all paints are similar, whether the company is A, B, or C, or D. In fact, in blind test, it will be very difficult to say which company's product is which one. They are so similar. That's why the dealers and the painters know this fact. They paint anybody's base with anybody's machine.
And in parallel, to add on that, what we're trying to do is to work with the painter community, essentially to educate them, saying that if you need this shade, you don't have the machine with you, this is the shade and the color, and if you work on somebody else's machine, this is how you can get it. A lot of the painters who work with us regularly already know that. What we need to do is to spread it further so that they get comfortable with the fact that they can get the same shade, and tinting machine doesn't become like a big barrier for us.
And you mentioned about a new player. I think in any industry it happens when the industry is growing, like paint industry is growing around 10% year after year. New players are bound to come, and there is a space for that. A player takes around 3 to 5 years to come, doesn't come overnight, and the entrant, which started some 3 years back, has still to establish itself. So it takes 3 to 5 years for a person to come, and growing at 10% year after year, there is enough space available for one or two entrants to come at every 5 to 10 years.
Okay. And if you look at the global picture, you will see that it's an extremely fragmented market compared to what we have been for the past few decades, in fact. So yes, high time that competition comes in, and it was bound to come in. And in fact, it will become further cluttered in the coming few years. But I think it was needed for the category as a whole. And if each one of us can operate in a niche, I think everybody has the potential to grow in that niche.
Okay. And one last question. Do we have any plans for fundraising?
As and when we have any plans, we'll definitely come back to you.
All right, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Aditya Shah, an investor. Please go ahead.
Congratulations on coming one step closer to profitability. A couple of questions. One was, when we target to hit this 900 to 1,000 crore sort of revenue, is that when we're targeting the 10 to 12% EBITDA margin, or do you think that will come earlier?
No, it will come at that time itself, yeah. It may come slightly earlier also. Let's see. We are targeting 10% EBITDA margin, and let us see how many it comes, because currently we are only at around 6 to 7%. So it's still a long way to go.
Got it. So now when you're going to further increase the sales, I guess the other expenses and cost of materials should more or less rise along with revenue. But are we seeing that we'll stick to this number of employee expenses, or in order to increase the sales, we'll also have to increase that?
So as we grow our volumes and revenue, our cost of materials as a percentage of revenue will slowly come down. Our other fixed costs will remain almost stable. In fact, some of our costs may come down, because as we grow, it will be possible to bargain better. So our employee costs will remain almost at the same current level. As a percentage, obviously, they will come down then. So overall, we hope to improve our profitability significantly, both because of the decreased cost of materials and because very limited change in the fixed cost.
And so you mentioned that the reason that we had no growth on a year-on-year basis as compared to, you know, the competition having 20-25% growth was because our geographic markets were more affected. Are we seeing that in this current Q4 things are going back to normal, or are we still will we still not be able to get growth on a year-on-year basis on the coming
In Q4 of 21, we are trying to get a growth over corresponding period of last year.
Understood. And so last question was, I was just going through your presentation. Out there is increase in production volumes was greater than the actual volume growth of sales. Was that just because of inventory stocking or something I'm not getting?
Yeah, there is some increase in the inventory of finished goods, slightly. And also because there has been some shifting in terms of the between industrial and decorative segments. So there has been a marginal shift, but that is only very, very marginal, not much.
Understood. And would there be, I'm assuming until we hit these 900,000 crore revenue, there would be no large capex, but what would be the maintenance capex annually that you all have?
We are looking for a very small maintenance capex of within 10 crore rupees year after year for next 3 years.
Understood, sir. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is in the line of Manish, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Thank you so much for giving an opportunity to ask you some questions. So my first question was to Ashok Gupta, sir. Sir, I know you are a part of the APL Apollo board as well. So can you share the relationship as to, I mean, you are currently, what you say, working with Shalimar Paints. So you are also on the board of APL Apollo. Is that correct?
I am a non-executive director on the board of APL Apollo.
Okay. So do both these business groups have any relationship? I guess not, but I just wanted to understand that.
There is no relationship between the Jindal Group, Ratan Jindal Group, and APL Apollo Group.
Okay. Second was, since you spoke about the 30% growth year on year, do we think we'll hit the 30% growth rate next financial year?
Yes. Hopefully, we will reach 30%. We are hoping to reach 30% growth next financial year. And
okay.
We are planning accordingly. Our objective is that. Our target is that.
Okay. At the cash profit level, I know, I mean, we've done really well in the previous two quarters. But at a net profit level, when do we think we will break even? Is it again going to be next year or it may take some more time?
The day you see me very happy, we have crossed net profit.
Sorry, sir. Can you repeat that once
again? We are working on it. I think we will. We are working on it. We cannot say when we will do it because it all depends. But we are working on reaching net PBTS level as well as fast as possible.
Okay. And my final request was when I visit the website of Shalimar Paints, I don't see the call script being uploaded. So I don't find it for all the three quarters. This year, obviously, the third quarter con call is happening only now. So I don't find it for the first two quarters. So if we can do something about that, please.
We will do it.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, anyone wishing to ask a question, may please press star in one. The next question is from the line of Dilip Sahu, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. I think most of our conversations are around decorative paints. Can you tell me what is our strategy in industrial paints? What is the current size and what is our aspiration in the next 3 years? Will it go in sync with the 30% that you are talking about? As well as some financial metrics in comparison with the decorative point paints, how does it fare in terms of the financial returns? Thank you.
Thank you for the question. You see, Shalimar has a good name in industrial paints. Within industrial paints, there are a couple of categories that we are quite strong. One of them is protective paints, which are basically used for corrosion protection of steel and allied matter. Second is packaging. The packaging is paints are used for your containers for food items and edible items. And third is marine. We are pretty known in marine paints, used in boats, particularly in the hull. But volume-wise and revenue-wise, well, most of the volume comes from corrosion resistance or protective coatings. Now, in protective coating, there are two or three aspects. One is protective coating for manufactured goods, goods which are manufactured in the factories. We are a OEM supplier to many of the manufacturers of steel items. So that is one segment where we are strong and we are growing and we hope to grow continuously. We are focusing on that. We are increasing our product range. We are developing new products. And I am happy to share with you that we may perhaps be having a significant or a large share in that market, which is going to grow as we increase our product range. See, hitherto, we were limited by our resources, so we didn't invest much in R&D, but now we have started investment in R&D, and we're getting good results. I'm happy to again share with you that in this protective coating, there are some paints which where we are perhaps the only one or one of the few manufacturers. So far as packaging is concerned, we were there at one point of in a significant manner. In between for a few years, we were almost absent. Now again, we have picked up the reins. We are getting very good growth. In fact, our growth rate in packaging paints is more than 100% at this moment. So we hope to continue that growth. And as they say, in days to come, the market is very big. You know, we have hardly 2% market share. So here again, we see a large potential. And third part of the industrial paints is marine, as I mentioned to you. Here again, our paints are very well accepted and are in a good demand, particularly in Kerala and in Gujarat. So we hope to increase the geographical spread of this distribution, and because there are a large number of small players involved here, small customers involved here, so we will increase that. So industrial paints, I hope is our growth will be more than 30%.
Okay. So may I ask one more question? So since the players for industrial painting are different, is the competitive intensity very different compared to decorative painting? There is a whole set of dynamics with the B2B business, etc. So can you just elaborate a little bit on that, as well as the financials? Does it look better because you are strongly placed and it's a B2B business, and maybe so in terms of return on capital, etc., how does it look comparative to decorative?
So you see, the competitive environment in industrial paint is a bit different. Whereas in decorative paints, our competition is the large players, the 4 or 5 large players. Our competition in industrial paint is significantly with small players whose values, whose volumes, whose revenue from industrial category is almost similar to our levels. So if I am doing a revenue of around 100-150 crores from industrial, then my competitors, in fact, may be having revenue, annual revenue of 50-60 crores to 200-250 crores, but not too much. So there I am almost standing on an equal footing. And within that, I am totally absent in automobile. I'm not there in automobile at all. So that's within, if I exclude automobile, I am a significant player in industrial. That's why what we are, our strategy is to become stronger and more stronger in industrial. We were having limitations of R&D spend till now. Now we are going a big way in R&D spend. With that R&D spend, our strength in industrial will be even more. Even today, of that entire potential available to me in industrial, I have not even focused on more than 30-40%. Slowly, I'll increase it. My bandwidth is limited. I'll make it 30-40 to 50-60-70-80 and maybe slightly more. So my strategy on industrial side is a bit stronger because there, A, it depends on my paint quality. It depends on my approvals. It depends on my certifications. And again, I'm happy to share with you the certifications we have got in Shalimar's name from international bodies are comparable to or a shade better than many others. So I'm much better wicket here. And fortunately, in industrial paints, brand plays a limited role. And approvals and certifications and quality plays a more important role, which are my strong points.
Okay, great. Thank you. In the initial comment, you said that in India, it is 75-25, whereas globally, the ratio is more in favor of industrial paint. So do you see industrial paint going in double digit compared to 10% in decorative in next 4 to 5 years?
So far as global demand is concerned, I don't see demand per se growing higher for industrial. But ideally, if you ask me, I have no idea. I have no study I have seen which differentiates between industrial and decorative growth-wise. So my hunch, I have absolutely no idea how it will grow. But my hunch is, even that the decorative segment will grow at 10%, 11%. Industrial may also grow at around same percentage. The reason being that in decorative segment, a host of new markets are opening up. Markets are opening up in terms of rural areas. Markets are opening up in terms of frequent repainting. So these are the new markets which are opening up. So demand for decoratives will also grow at around 10 to 12%, and demand for industrial may also grow at same or slightly higher percentage.
So to add on to that, yes, industrial growth rate might pick up, but there are many more macro factors involved in it. And why for us, we've not matched up to the global rate. So why for us, in the past, it's been a little low. I think it's because the amount of investment that's needed in infrastructure, the amount of investment that's needed in technology for something that like that, for us to deliver, for our industry to deliver, hasn't been there. So I think it's a combination of quite a few things which individual players will not manage to tackle. It depends on government. It depends on how much of investment is coming in here. And if that happens, then yes, we will pick up the growth rate compared to the global counterparts.
Thank you very much. Can I say that the core sectors like steel and aluminium will be a proxy to the growth in industrial? Is that a good proxy to say if the consumption of aluminium and steel grows up, we can take that industrial painting will also grow up because of basically capital, white goods, automobile, etc., etc.
Yeah, I think you are right. These are the basic products, the core products, steel, aluminium, cement, and their growth is a good indication of the overall growth in the industrial sector, in the infrastructure sector, where the industrial paints are used.
Okay. So, one last question is, say, compared to a Nerolac or a ExxonMobil, you talked about our positioning as a very strong player in certain segments in industrial, but say, I'm not talking about automobile. I know that automobile is a very closed industry for painting and maybe going to the Nerolac. But outside automobile, how are we compared to a Nerolac versus and ExxonMobil in industrial painting?
So we are still slightly away from them, but we are catching up. But we are not too far away, not like decorative. So here the gap is much lower. But yes, we are almost on equal footing when it comes to non-automobile industrial paints.
Okay. That's great. Thank you very much, sir.
Welcome, sir.
Thank you. The next question is on the line of Narendra Porwal, an investor. Please go ahead. Narendra, your line is on the talk mode. Please go ahead.
Sir, awaaz aa rahi hai meri?
आ रही है ना, ठीक आ रही है
सर. मैं अपना क्वेश्चन हिंदी में पूछूंगा सर. अशोक जी गुप्ता, आपको मैं सबसे पहले तो धन्यवाद दूंगा कि आप गुजरात अपोलो ट्यूब जैसी कंपनी को बहुत ऊपर लेके आए और अब हमारी कंपनी में आए हैं. पर सर, हम अपनी कंपनी का एडवर्टाइज बजट क्यों नहीं बढ़ा रहे हैं सर? जिस तरह से अभी मार्केट में नई हिंदी को पेंट आई है और उन्होंने जिस तरह से अपना एडवर्टाइज बजट बना के और जिस तरह से ग्रोथ की है, हम सर इंडिया के पायोनियर से राष्ट्रपति भवन से
सर आपकी लाइन से बहुत डिस्टर्बेंस आ रही है.
अच्छा, मैडम तो हम मतलब क्या है कि हम इतनी पुरानी कंपनी है और राष्ट्रपति भवन से लगा के हावड़ा ब्रिज तक हर जगह हम अपना काम कर चुके हैं, तो हम क्यों ना एडवर्टाइज में उस चीज को अपने फॉलो करें कि हम इस तरह से इंडिया के पायोनियर सर, हम इस तरह से अपने ग्रोथ बढ़ा सकते हैं, ऐसा प्लांट मैनेजमेंट क्यों नहीं सोच रही है? दूसरा क्वेश्चन मेरा ऐसा रहेगा कि हमारा जो कलकत्ता में जो प्लांट्स है वो भी बंद है, तो क्या हम वहाँ की लैंड को भी अपने यूटिलाइज कर सकते हैं ऐसा कुछ?
हाँ, बहुत अच्छा आपने सही पूछा कि दोनों चीज हैं, क्यों नहीं हम एडवर्टाइजमेंट करके अपने सेल को बढ़ाएं, और दूसरा हमारा हावड़ा में लैंड पड़ा हुआ है, इसको हम क्या कर सकते हैं. तो देखिए, ऐसा है कि हमको अपनी सेल बढ़ानी है. सेल बढ़ाने के लिए एडवर्टाइजमेंट और ब्रांडिंग जो है वो अपना एक रोल अदा करती है. उसके अलावा और भी फैक्टर्स हैं और कई तरीके हैं अपनी बात को अपने कंज्यूमर तक पहुंचाने के लिए. जो आपने हमारी ग्रोथ अभी तक देखी है उसी तरीके से आई है कि हमने अपनी बात कंज्यूमर तक पहुंचाई है और वहां से हमें रिस्पांस मिल रहा है और हम ब्रांडिंग कर रहे हैं. बाकी डिटेल में आपको मेन्यू बताएंगे हम क्या कर रहे हैं. दूसरा, जो आपने क्वेश्चन पूछा हावड़ा के बारे में, तो हावड़ा प्लांट हमारा कुछ समय से बंद है, लेकिन हावड़ा में हमारी अच्छी मार्केट है, ईस्ट में हमारी अच्छी मार्केट है. तो हमको जो है हावड़ा प्लांट के बारे में सोचना पड़ेगा, और जैसे ही हम कुछ हावड़ा प्लांट के बारे में फैसला लेते हैं हम आपको बताएंगे.
नहीं सर, हमारे हावड़ा प्लांट में कितने एकड़ लैंड होगी ऑलमोस्ट?
हमारे प्लांट के अंदर जो लैंड है वो करीब करीब 20 एकड़ के आसपास होंगे.
अच्छा, और फ्री लैंड भी होगी या उतनी ही है?
मतलब टोटल लैंड हमारे पास जो है वहाँ पे वो 20 एकड़ के आसपास होनी चाहिए. मैं एग्जैक्टली तो मैं जानता नहीं हूँ कितनी है, बट आई थिंक 20 एकड़ के आसपास है.
नहीं सर, एक्चुअली मैं गुजरात से बोल रहा हूँ, तो हमारा आपने बोला कि गुजरात में आपका प्रेजेंस अच्छा है तो हमको भी दिख रहा है, पर कंपनी की एडवर्टाइज बजट नहीं हो रहा, ये हमको बहुत दिक्कत हो रही है लग रहा है.
हाँ, तो ये इसके जो इंचार्ज है ना एडवर्टाइजमेंट की, वो सजेशन आपका ले लेंगे. मैंने आपका सजेशन ले लिया है और उसके ऊपर वो जरूर एक्ट करेंगे, मुझे उम्मीद है. करेंगे इस पे काम, कुछ ना कुछ काम करेंगे इस पे.
बढ़िया.
थैंक यू.
थैंक यू. The next question is from the line of Bilal Qureshi, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hello, thank you for taking my question. Mr. Gupta, I can say that the Q3 was a good quarter. December sales were approximately 33 crores. How was the month of January past? Have we posted a growth on month-on-month basis?
January is almost at a similar level as December. There has not been much of a change in December as in January as compared to December. But we are expecting that February and March should be better.
Okay. And so we have posted a cash profit of 1 crore. Also, efficiency is improving quarter by quarter. So will we be posting a net positive number by Q4 or by Q1?
We are trying our best. So let me tell you that we understand the our concerns and desires of our investors very well, and but we are trying our very best. There are things which are sometimes not in our control, but whatever may happen, we are trying our best that we should do it as early as possible.
Okay, sir. As I'm very favorable that you are a non-executive director of APL Apollo. So the kind of business model we have built, I'm an investor in APL Apollo from 2011. Okay. So this kind of cash and carry business model I've never seen. So in the long run, are we trying the same thing 5 to 6, 10 years?
One day, hopefully, Shalimar also will have a better model than what it is today. We will also work towards cash. If not cash and carry, then at least a short credit model.
Okay. In September, when we had a call, you had said that we had 2,000 distributors, dealers, and we had a target of 5,000. What's the current number then?
See, it is anywhere between 2,500 to 3,000. They slightly goes on varying. There's no exact number, but this is between 2,500 to 3,000, anywhere there.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, due to time constraint, that was the last question. I now hand the conference over to the management for the closing comments.
So I must thank all the participants. We had a very interesting session, and the best part was the questions were really, quite in depth. The knowledge was very good, and some of the participants knew right to the last extent what is going on in the company. I really appreciate, and this only makes me happy and proud that people are aware of my company. And this also prompts me to provide more and more information to our investors on our site. So next time when you will see our presentation, much more information will be provided in our investors' presentation. So our investors are much more aware of what is going on in the company. Let me tell you, we are on the right track. We have seen good traction, both from the dealers, from the customers, from the OEMs, as well as from our own employees. Things are good. Things will be better in the future. Thank you so much for your participation.
Thank you.